Hey, everybody, before we get started today, we have some vital news for Apple Podcast listeners. In case you haven't heard, Apple recently did another update. This update kicked a lot of our followers off the show and paused notifications for new episodes. It even happened to some of our own team members, so you definitely want to check out your settings. To see if this happened to you, open your podcast app, search for the 200% Life, and select the show page. In the top right corner, you may see either a follow button or a pause symbol. Tap either one of those to make sure you are following the show and getting new downloads. This really helps you by making sure new episodes show up in your feed so you never miss an episode. It also makes sure new episodes are downloaded to your phone so you can listen to them when you're not connected to Wi-Fi. It's also really helpful to us. When you follow the show, the algorithm helps us spread the 200% Life philosophy to new listeners. This is true for other platforms as well. So while you're at it, whether you listen on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or another favorite platform, please be sure to hit the follow, subscribe, or like button. This helps us reach new listeners and teach them how to use business as a conduit for their personal growth. And as always, we'd love to hear any questions you'd like us to cover on the show. Maybe it's a situation you're struggling with personally, or a topic you think would be helpful to a friend. You can drop your questions in the Q&A box in the show notes on Spotify, or you can email us at hello@adamhergenrother.com. And don't forget to turn on your notifications to be alerted when we cover them. Hey everybody, I'm Adam Hergenrother, and this is Business Meets Spirit Chat, and we believe in personal growth through business success. Today I am joined by my chief of staff, Hallie. Hallie, good morning. You can probably hear it. Can you hear it in the voice? Yeah, I have like these allergies. And you know what the funny thing is about this is I've never really gotten allergies before. And over the last couple of years, maybe that I'm getting into my 30s, it's into my 40s. I should just turn 40s. Let's not over exaggerate into my 40s. Or late 30s. It's kind of the same thing, right? It's just plus or minus 6 months. So, I mean, it's like a plus or minus.
Numbers don't lie, though.
They don't. But I mean, it's like late 30s could also potentially be.
It could. I mean, that's true.
Math doesn't really lie that way. But anyway, so ever since I got a little bit older, the allergies have crept in. And for some reason this year, they're really bad. But it's funny because it's not like a sinus thing. It's more of just like my throat. And when you speak all the time, it's frustrating. It's like we're in like a room, like some of our accountants who are, you know, not having to jump on and speak as much. But when you're here, so I'm just letting everybody know that my voice is a little raspy, so you're gonna have to bear with me for that one. Mm-hmm. But today I want to jump in on a conversation of, we wrapped up Project U a couple weeks ago, and we had a couple of guest speakers, but one of them was his name is Mike Smith. You should actually look him up if you haven't. He was a Navy SEAL, which always kind of checks the box for me because of his mental fortitude that he had. But also he's been the CEO of private and public companies too. He was the guy, by the way, who they always called to come in and fix companies, right? He actually didn't enjoy, it's really interesting. I don't know if you remember, I tried to hire him. Remember back in Colchester, mm-hmm. back, he came into my office and I tried to hire him for UPI.
Yes, we did.
And he actually walked in, he said, you know, Adam, he goes, everything sounds good, but he's like, I think you're just doing too well. I'm like, well, what do you mean? He goes, I come into companies that are a complete mess.
Yeah.
And I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but like, that's essentially what they were, like turnaround bankruptcies.
Right.
Like, and he's done some really big turnarounds in our area, which, you know, colleges, Comcast was one of them. Right. So a lot of like those bigger things. Then most recently, it was really interesting for him. He jumped on, the governor called him to become the director of
Secretary of Human Services,
which
at end of 2019 is when he took the position.
Yeah. And he was overseeing 3,800 people. And he said in the first 3 months, then of course, you know, COVID hit and pandemic hit and Vermont led the country in a lot of the stats that people were measuring it. And they're in their 1, 2, or 3 in just about every single stat, which is pretty cool. And it was fun to talk about that. But the real purpose of bringing him up is he came and he spoke to our group. And one of the things he said, which really resonated with me, there's actually two things, but the first one was he was describing a leadership philosophy. And I think this is really important for a leadership philosophy, for not only business, but for your life. And that's kind of how I can really see it. Is he basically said in the Navy SEALs, you're taught when you're in an ambush. So if you're in a firefight of some sort, you don't want to
retreat. So meaning like if somebody comes in, you're walking into an ambush and all of a sudden the natural tendency for people is to retreat. But he said a lot of times there is a second ambush waiting because that's what naturally people do is they fall back or retreat.
And the enemy expects it.
And the enemy kind of expects it. Yeah, thank you for sharing that, right? The second component is that so that's what you don't want to do. Is, and his title of this kind of leadership philosophy was always charge the ambush. And I think that's a great metaphor for our lives, for in any aspect that we're doing, always charge the ambush. But he said, the minute you charge an ambush, it kind of catches them by surprise in terms of the Navy SEALs, right? Like they're not expecting it. So they're like, wow, what's actually happening here? And then the third component to it is once you actually make it through the ambush, you're in the clear. And I thought that was a really good metaphor for our lives.
Generally,
right?
Yes.
Because how many, and this can go from everything from a conversation you need to have to an employee that you need to have a conversation with or hire or dehire, a conversation you need to have in your personal life. How many of these ambushes are we retreating from and then constantly thinking about them over and over again? What was your takeaway when you heard that?
Well, I mean, when you don't, for me, it's just that you have to face whatever obstacle is in front of you, whatever your struggle is. Head on. That's how I took it. And every time you retreat from it, other obstacles tend to pop up, whether that's just more anxiety. If you're not facing a conversation, you don't have as much clarity because you're worrying about something that you should be doing, but you just haven't faced it yet. So then it takes up all this headspace and time and energy that you didn't really need if you had just gone towards that ambush or gone towards that obstacle and faced it head on and really moved through it. You don't need to necessarily... You don't want to stop there, right? You got to move, keep moving through it.
Yeah, it's like you just want to. I kind of want to get a T-shirt because I love T-shirts anyways. Just says "Charge the ambush." I think you emailed me that. Yeah, you did. You did. Just put it out there.
It's like, always charge the ambush.
Always charge the ambush, and that's just a good metaphor for your life in terms of again when you're also and think about it like when you go into charging the ambush, you kind of have to let go of the outcome. So that's the other technique that you have to be able to bring in here because a lot of reasons why people wouldn't charge an ambush is obviously they don't want the threat of dying in like in that type of situation, but in more like practical situations, because we're not probably in SEALs and ambushes, is like we're afraid of an outcome or how we're going to feel from charging this ambush. Mm-hmm. And so instead, it's actually a very good spiritual path too, because the minute you charge an ambush, you're actually going into it. You're allowing the event to unfold and work its way through you so that it's actually moved through you. Instead of, like you said, retreating from it or pretending that it doesn't exist, it's like you're pushing the event back down. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't work. It works for a moment.
Temporarily.
And then it comes back over and over again. It's like beating you up.
Worse.
Way worse. Yeah. And then it gets to a point where it's like, man, this has gone on so long that I don't even want to have this conversation. How do I even have it anymore? And then you get even more into it. So it just delays and delays and delays. People can do this with their health. They can do this with their businesses, they can do this with their personal lives, all these different things that are going on here. People have this this natural reaction to not want to charge the ambush. But I think if you're always willing to look at whatever is head on for you and go right into it, then regardless of the outcome, you're in the clear. Because every time, and you guys don't need to be a psychologist to understand this, think about a time that you've faced something head on, even if it was really scary and you did it, first of all, the outcomes usually is never as bad as we've dreamed it up in our minds first, right? It just usually isn't.
Well, similarly, I was just going to say, and it's all the worst part is the anxiety and the stress and the worry and fear leading up to whatever it is that you're going to do.
That's exactly right.
And then once you do it, step, like for me, it was like the one that always comes to mind because I can still feel it like internally is that like speaking publicly.
Yes.
So horrible. But as I stepped on the stage, it was actually over for the most part because it was what it was, but it was all of the days leading up to it that were the worst.
Yeah. And that's the suffering, right? It's the suffering until you actually go and get on with it. There's this anxiety that causes suffering in a human being. And you can just avoid it if you're just always willing to charge the ambush. Now, it doesn't mean you're reckless with that. Like if there's a time to think about things or a time to have the conversation, that's different than, but the majority of time is we're beating ourselves up over it because we're afraid of some outcome that our minds have dreamt up that's going to happen when we walk in there and have the conversation, start taking action towards something, you know, write an email or whatever that action is going to be when you put yourself through there. But the best way to live is actually to be able to jump through there, because once you're actually through there, that energy that's been holding you down actually removes itself, and the clarity actually shows up. And that's the really interesting thing about decisions. The reason why people struggle so much with decisions is because it's not really there. They're not actually struggling with the decision. They're really just tossing around, how is this going to make me feel based on this decision? And that's not really the best way to make a decision. The best way to make a decision is to how to contribute and serve to the moment. But most of us are actually making a decision of how it's going to internally make them feel versus what is the best decision for me to be able to do right here. So if you know the best decision is to have a conversation with an employee, for instance, right? You not willing to have that conversation is actually hurting the entire organization, because you've taken a self-indexed approach to that, because you're like, I don't want to deal with this emotion from it, instead of actually just dealing with the situation.
That reminds me of, whether it's a decision or just sometimes when you ask people, you know, what do you want to do, or what is it that you want? And they're like, well, I don't really know. Yeah. I always say, I really truly believe people really do know. It's mm-hmm. just, they are afraid to say it because of judgment, mm-hmm. other people's opinions, what the outcome might be if they do say it out loud, mm-hmm. like all of that stuff. I mean, sure, I'm sure there are people who don't know, but again, even decisions, most people know what to do. Most people know what they want. It's just all that other noise and chatter around that makes it complicated to just say it out loud.
There's actually been a lot of research on that too, right? Where it's the decision that usually is made is the first one. The first one that comes to mind.
Yeah.
Because it's almost like when it comes to mind, then what you're doing is you're tossing it back and forth of saying, okay, and it's not, we're not saying don't think, right? That's different.
Right, right.
Thinking through a solution is not the same. And you should all need to hear this and pay attention to this. Thinking through a solution is different than asking the question of how is this decision going to make me personally feel? Mm-hmm. Having a decision of how's this going to interact with life or the business, or how it's going to affect our clients or our employees, that's a completely different scenario of using your mind just to going, how am I going to feel based on me personally going to feel from this decision?
Right.
And the kind of an easy way to look at that is like when people put clothes on every morning, right? Most people know how it feels to put clothes on. But when you're looking in the mirror, right, you're not really looking to see how it feels. Because you already know how it feels. You're looking to see how it looks on you and how it hits your stuff. Meaning like, how do I feel wearing this?
Because I was going to say, wait, but it is about feelings.
It's about the internal feeling, not the right. actual comfort of what a clothing's supposed to do.
Oh, yes. You mean not like a touch, but a...
I mean, you kind of put clothes on, you know if it's... Yes, exactly. you put clothes on and you know that if it's warm, if it's keeping you cold based on the temperature that's outside,
right.
or
if the clothes are scratchy.
Yes, exactly. Is it comfortable?
Yeah.
You don't need to look in the mirror to find if it's comfortable. What you're really doing is you're looking in the mirror. I did that because I don't really look in the mirror, and I happened to look in the mirror today and I was like, man, I'm looking in the mirror to see actually how this makes me feel.
But don't you sometimes look to see what it looks like?
Sure, you can do that. I'm just, my whole point is saying, there's nothing wrong with it, right? The whole point is like, you just don't get attached to it. Because like, if you don't like the way it looks, you instantly go, well, I can't wear this outfit. Even though it's really comfortable, I can't wear it.
Right.
But my point is like, there's nothing wrong. And you can change your outfit, you can wear the outfit. It's irrelevant. But just that's the interaction that we're having with these larger decisions that a lot of times are going on, which is, how is this decision going to make me feel? And spiritual personal growth is all about letting go of the part of you that is going to be uncomfortable about having the conversation or making the decision or letting go of the outcome. When you're able to let go of the outcome, and what you're letting go of, you're not letting go of the result, you're letting go of the result of you, right? Of how you're personally going to benefit or gain from this. Now, there's nothing wrong with setting up contracts to make money, to do those different things. I'm not talking about that. We're going back to that same example of when you charge an ambush, if you're always charging an ambush, there's going to be a lot of uncomfortableness there. And so you're not pausing to be able to see how you're going to deal with it and then not have the conversation because you're unwilling to experience how you're going to feel from it. And if you, that's the difference there. So that's what I really took away from that is when you charge the ambush, you actually get into the habit of being uncomfortable, right? Mm-hmm. In those situations until it works its way through you. And then you start to realize, man, I don't want to keep this in here. Why can't I just have the conversation anyways? Why can't I be clear just to have the conversation?
The one other thing that I took away from the always charge the ambush was that Again, you see the obstacle in front of you, you accept whatever it is, you're accepting that ambush, but then for me, by charging it, you're taking control whatever it is. And rather than retreating or not knowing what to do, we're running in a different direction. It's, you accept it and then you take control.
Yeah.
And you act.
Yeah. So what is something that you are, avoiding? Or you smiling? Like you just,
I was like, are you actually asking me? I don't know if I want to talk about that.
I'm just asking more of the audience, like just as a rhetorical question for you to kind of to think about, like what is, or start small. Like don't go tackle the big things that you know you're not going to go do, right? Just go, hey, you know what? I'm avoiding calling this client because I don't want to have a price reduction conversation, which by the way, in real estate, in our world, is going to be pretty interesting pretty soon. You know, most people have never had to have price reduction conversations. And I just remember the call reluctancy that comes in when you go list a property. And this is going to be so prevalent in real estate in the coming weeks.
Say, not for a couple of years at least.
Well, it's been 3 or 4 years and you've had to really have these conversations at scale, right?
Yes.
Whereas, you know, and so now it's as, you know, when a market starts to shift and it's shifting worldwide, regardless of where you're listening to this, right? When the market starts to shift and people are, and prices are coming down and less home sales are actually occurring, then people still want to get top dollar for their home. So they list it and then you have to have the price conversation. But what a lot of people do is they're almost like start to get afraid of having those conversations. Mm-hmm. Is they like, I should have it today. And then you're like, I don't want to have it today. I'm not feeling that. And it's like tomorrow I should have it. Yeah. And then you kind of just honestly, if people, I've seen this go on, it's like they get to so point where they get so bad, they don't even want to call the client, have the conversation anymore. And they just like, we'll let the listing expire. Now, right.
They see him in the coffee shop and they go turn the other way.
Yeah. And it's like, look, that's, we're stretching the story there a little bit, but people understand the point. Sure. And there's plenty of people that get up and just have direct conversation. Right. And there's nothing wrong with it. If you're willing to always let go of the outcome, there is no conversation you wouldn't have. Remember that. The only reason why people never have a conversation is because they're afraid of the outcome. If you're never afraid of the outcome, then have the conversation. People don't want to get on the scale. They don't want to look in their bank account. They don't want to have the conversation with their partner. They don't want to have a conversation with their kids about anything right now. Like whatever that is for you, it's different for everybody. Some people go, I'll have that conversation with my spouse, but I get into work and I can't, right? So everyone has a different trigger that's preventing them from taking that action or having that conversation. And it all comes from that you're afraid of the outcome. And what I mean by the afraid of the outcome, not the outcome itself, you're afraid of how the outcome is going to make you personally feel. So hence the whole point of doing all of this work, spirituality, business meets spirituality, is that you use business, that part of you that's going to be hurt, let that part go, and you become clear to have conversations and deal and interact with life. Are you going to say something?
I just wanted to know, like, what are you avoiding right now? Anything?
No, but there was something I was avoiding like a month ago that I ended up just picking up the phone and having the conversation with. But it was just one of our folks. I just didn't want to deal with the conversation. Mm-hmm. And then finally I was just like, you know what it really came down to was, I was like, I'm sick of having this showing back up in my mind space.
Yes.
I was like, I don't care about the decision. I have to let go of the outcome and I just have to show up for the conversation and see it. Actually, the conversation was better than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah, it always is,
right? Yeah. And even if it's not, right? It's there. So it's just, but I got to a point where I was like, what am I doing? Like, this is showing up on a drive home when I'm about to go be with my family. And now it's taking even a small percent of me away because now I'm having to let go of this while I'm trying to interact with my family instead of showing up there.
Right. Or even just like, sometimes I was like justifying to yourself why you don't need to do it right now. And again, that's just taking you out of whatever the present moment is.
Totally. And I wasn't even justifying. I was just like, I don't want to deal with it. Like I shouldn't, it's almost more of like, I shouldn't have to be dealing with this.
Right. That isn't that a justification.
Okay. Yeah. So it is. Yes. But anyway, so it was more of that justification. And then it just would, the pattern would kind of go on and I was like, I just need to, so I just picked the phone and called. And again, it's never as bad. It's the outcome is never what you 99.99% of the time. It's never what people think it is. Ever, especially the train tracks that your mind is taking you on, right? Because once you get involved with that mind clutter of it's telling you like, oh, this outcome is going to happen. I mean, how many people like, you know, have gotten sick over the last 2 years with a sore throat and be like, I've got COVID, right? Like it's going to be there. And you go, you test and you don't have COVID, right? I mean, think about that. I mean, 75 to 80% of the tests I think are negative, right? So it's like,
but I was going to just say that it's not as simple as saying, oh no, I think I have COVID. It's
totally,
oh no, I think I have COVID.
Yeah.
And what am I going to I'm going to be out of work now. And what am I
my kids going to do? Yes.
And I have to take the dogs, but I can't take the dogs because I'm stuck at home. And how am I going to get groceries? Yes. And then it's like all of this stuff.
That's exactly. Then you're like, then what am I going to do? Like, I'm not going to get tested. But then if I don't get tested, I don't do this, right? This whole mind chatter goes on, right? Just using that as an example. It's all of those things show up. That's the train that the mind will take you on, right? And so again,
how do you stop that?
Well, you just,
I mean, it just happens.
Yeah. Well, so there's the three modalities of how you can stop that, right? You can always, number one is you can always replace it with a positive, this positive affirmation, right? It works. Positive affirmation works. So if the mind shows up in there and says, oh man, I really need a new boat. You go, I love my boat, or I don't need a boat. Or in this case where it's like, oh my God, maybe I have to pay, maybe I do, maybe I don't. Right, you just replace it with a positive thought. That is always the first modality, which is what you're doing.
Think of it like as just like redirecting.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. You can redirect it, whatever word makes sense for you. Just replacing the thought that comes in with a neutralizing thought. That's a way to think of it, right? You're neutralizing the thought that comes in, because if you don't neutralize it, what it's going to do is take you down that train track, mm-hmm. right? And it's going to, next thing you know, you're going to be seven layers deep that you don't even realize where you are. And you've been driving for 15 minutes and your mind's gone crazy, right? We've all been there, so we can understand that. So the first is when the thought comes in there, if you can't do the second or third modality, you always go to the first one and just neutralize it. So when a thought comes in there, you can always replace it with something, mm-hmm. right? It can be everything like, oh, I need a new job. No, I don't really need a new job. Right. Then maybe you go get a new job, right? It's not that. It's just you're not allowing that thought that just shows up out of nowhere, right? In the case that I was telling you about, I remember I was driving home and it was perfect out. I was getting around there, and all of a sudden the thought came in there and I was like, wow, this wave of negative energy showed up in my life. Like, it's showing me, like, it's basically that little sign that says, let go of this, right? That's that charging that ambush, or always charge the ambush, at least in my life, to get those things out faster. The second modality of that is always having some level of mantra going on, right? Which is like, and the mantra doesn't have to be a Sanskrit word, right? It could, but it doesn't have to be God, or it could be it could be any. It could just be like, I can handle this. I can handle this. I can handle this. Life is great. Life is great, right? I'm whole. It's irrelevant. The whole point is you have a mantra kind of going on, and if it's going on, it's almost like a safety net. And if you do it long enough, it just kind of exists in the background as almost like an air conditioner does, or a lawnmower on a Saturday morning that you don't really recognize going on until it stops. And you get that mantra going and it's just being said softly. So when the mind is trying to be penetrated by the original thought, you layer and you go directly put your consciousness instead of the thought that shows up, you put it on the mantra. And so it's like, if the case was like, I can handle this, and it's just like, it's going on. So then the thought tries to interrupt your life, and it does for a second, and then you just go, I can handle this. I can handle this. And next thing you know, the thought has passed. Mm-hmm. And so now you're back to clarity. So the first one is neutralizing and playing with the energy of the thought. The second one is just kind of more having a background, so it kind of starts to transmute the energy in itself, if you will.
Do you have a mantra going on?
Yeah, it's just kind of going,
constantly?
Yes. Yeah, I don't always think about it. It's not like I'm thinking at all times, but the minute, well, I do all three, right? But like the minute something comes in, if it's a lighter thing, I just go, I can handle this. That's kind of mine. I can handle this, right?
Yeah, but you don't like hear it going.
No,
constantly.
But it's in the background. So whenever you need it, it's there.
You just pull it.
And it's just like, so the minute the thought shows up, that's like, oh man, this is going to be really tough. And it's like, I can handle it. It just shows up instantaneously. I can handle this. And you go, well, there, I don't have to deal with it. I don't have to replace the thought, because the minute it goes, I can handle this, I can handle this. And then within seconds, or a minute, or an hour when you're first starting out, it is, next thing you know, it's just gone. And then you're not even thinking about the thinking of the thought. It's just, now you're back in the moment. And the third one, which is the highest state that you can do, which is really the transmutation of the energy, which is to understand that you're in there and you hear this, the nature of the mind is to produce thoughts. That's the first thing we people need to understand, that at the core, the mind is just a thought generating machine. I would say less than 5% of the thoughts are you generating the thought, right? It's like a bubble machine. Sometimes you plug it in. If it was plugged in all the time and there's a button, you can generate bubbles. But if the button's already on, it's just generating bubbles. It doesn't mean they're wrong. That's what it's doing. The same thing with the mind. It just generates thoughts. That's what it does. And we can get into why it does at a whole other time, but it just generates thoughts, right? I think everyone on this call listening to this can understand that the mind, you can be perfectly fine. The mind just comes up with a thought, mm-hmm. all the time. Most of them you just don't pay attention to. That's the funny thing. You're already doing this with most of them. Most of the time the thought comes in there, and if it didn't hit anything within you, it just kind of goes away, doesn't it? You drive by and you go, oh, you're like, oh, there's a tree. The tree's not bothering you. So next thing you know, the tree is out of your peripheral and you're not even paying attention to it anymore. But it's only these thoughts that hit something that you stored.
But if the tree is where your husband proposed to you.
Yes.
That would be different.
Yeah, because you stored a positive experience in there.
Yeah.
You no longer see just tree.
Right.
You now have a relationship with an object, right? Instead of actually just seeing the things. So it's then the third level is that, again, that the willingness to just watch everything. So the mind starts talking and you don't need to neutralize it. You don't even need to go to your mantra. You just watch it pass by. Even when it hits your stuff, even when it's going ballistic, everyone knows what that means. Like when it's just going and it's raging, mm-hmm. you're just watching it. You're going, look at that thing. Just talk constantly. And at that point, when you do that, you'll feel this almost burning sensation. It just shows up differently for everybody, but it's almost like you feel the energy of that working its way through you, and just, it just releases. The minute you've let it work through, it releases, and then that's gone. And then you're no longer having that stored within you. So those are the three modalities of that. So, letting go of the outcome becomes really important here, but the kind of mental model, if you want, is that always charge the ambush and just start with small things, right? Start with very small things. Most people are probably, there's a small conversation that you can have, maybe calling your parents, calling a friend.
Getting up when your alarm goes
getting
off.
Getting up when your alarm goes, something. It can be a whole bunch of things. Just stop avoiding that and just do it, right? And then that's instead of listening to that. So that can be a charge to ambush. The second component that I wanted to mention that I really enjoyed that he discussed was why he was even there in the first place, which was he believes that his legacy is in daily teachings, mm-hmm. which really hit home with me. Out of anybody that we had come in there, that was really profound for me. Because I it's leaving a legacy isn't about leaving objects or things, right? Those can be part of it. It's wonderful, but really in 100, 200, 500 years, nobody's going to know who you are. So like, what legacy are you really leaving? And so I like to look at it as like your legacy becomes your teachings, but not like, I need 1,000 people in an audience to teach, not that I need to be in a position or a job so that my job is teaching and caring. That's wonderful. It is, but your teachings just happen to be on an everyday basis. You're interacting with your family, you're interacting with friends, you're interacting with strangers. There's always an opportunity to teach, right? And I think that becomes your legacy, is teaching what you've learned. And that's the whole reason why so many people want to contribute later in life, whether you're in business or whether you're a school teacher or you know, whatever occupation that you've had. At some point, people wake up and go, hey, I want to give this back. It's almost like you're giving, you know, what you've learned so that we are constantly evolving as an organization, as a species, right? So like you're that's part of that contribution. So I like to, instead of like what is your legacy? I think it's your legacy is in your daily teachings.
Yeah, there are a couple of thoughts about that whole legacy conversation. I think, well, first of all, I always just think it's interesting no matter who we have speaking. For example, when we had Mike Smith, or even recently on one of our calls, we had someone speak, and it's always so interesting what things resonate with different people and what meaning people take from different things. Because yeah. For example, this whole legacy conversation was, I think, super interesting and was obviously very clearly impactful for you. It didn't hit me the same way,
yeah.
Which I think is really interesting because I always thought legacy was about teaching and never, but you know me, I don't usually look at material things.
Yeah.
So I never really thought legacy was about how much money you left to your grandkids or how much, you know, if you donated certain things to a library or to a hospital like that. For me, that never was legacy. It was always kind of like what Mike said. It's just about, it's like a living legacy. It's how do you live your life? How are you teaching others to become leaders? And that is the legacy, I think.
Yeah, I think you're spot on. I mean, I guess you're right. If I think about it, I always assumed legacy was with accumulation of things and handing that chest down to people.
Yeah, no, I never did.
And I knew that wasn't right. And I think when he said it, it actually became clearer for me as to what that actually is, and how I'm actually trying to live my life, which is these daily teachings, which life is your guru, right? We use business meets spirituality, but really it's life is spirituality, right? Which is spirituality is not changing what you do. It's not about getting married or having fun toys or buying cars or going on vacations. It's about what part of you is doing it.
Well, and I know I just think you can learn so much from history, and I'm very much about being present, right? It's not like living in the past. That's different. I'm not talking about that. I'm just talking about
absolutely.
There's patterns throughout history, right? And things you can learn from ancient cultures and ancient wisdom and whatever. But that's, to me, again, also almost like what humanity is in their culture, that the culture of humans is about teaching and passing down oral stories from one generation to the next. And that's how they learned how to live.
Yeah. Hunt, gather,
and
build.
Yes. And evolve, and then those eventually turned into writings from ancient philosophers, and those started being written down, and then that stuff started to become passed down, and I guess that's always what I just figured it was.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think you bring up a lot of good points, and it's even like the podcast is all the podcasts that are wonderful people are doing across the world, right? Are all teachings, mm-hmm. right? And it's like, now there's almost everyone's teaching to a certain point, which is wonderful because everyone resonates with different people.
Oh, exactly.
At different times. Right. Yes. I mean, that's the really neat thing. There's different seasons of your life. And one podcast or one episode may resonate with people, or the way somebody describes it may resonate. That's the whole, I tell you what really changed for me in terms of learning was when Audible came around, because I struggle sitting down and reading a book. Like I know you love it. So I know you,
I like both.
I know you do, but man, I tell you, I don't know what it was for my nature, what it was, I could do it and I would force myself. But the minute Audible came around, was that 12 years ago or some form of Audible? I think it was something before Audible.
You started doing CDs. Remember?
Yes, I was doing CDs. That's what it was. It was about 10, 12 years ago when I started doing like CDs and tapes, like really getting into that. And that's when I started consuming it. But now with Audible, now it became an exercise or in my car. It was so much easier to be able to bring all this stuff in there. So mm-hmm. content, teaching-wise, allows people to share their legacy. And whether one person listens to it or 100 million people listen to it, it's almost irrelevant. If somebody is taking it and better their life, then that's exactly what the whole point of it.
Yeah. And I know we talk about this all the time, but I'm reading the book Resilience by Eric Gratans, something like that. He's an ex-Navy SEAL.
Yeah, I remember that.
So I've never read the book, but he includes a lot of philosophy from, you know, Sophocles and Aristotle.
Yes, the Stoics.
Yeah, the Stoics. Yes. It's just fascinating to me how much of that is the exact same what we talk about. And I'm sure it will still be the exact same that's been talked about hundreds of years from, maybe not, I guess. But I mean, it's just, to me, it's just like, it's just the human experience.
Yeah.
And it's just different ways of connecting to different people at different times.
Yeah. You know, I mean, spirituality in itself, the teachings of spirituality or even teachings of religion, if that's your thing, has changed dramatically. Think about churches nowadays compared to 50 years ago. Right. I mean, and every church is different. So I'm not going to say that I'm the person to educate people in there. I just know from my mom still goes and she's like, you know, when I was growing up, we dressed up and now she's in jeans and a sweater and wearing and drinking coffee in there and doing those things. So that's what I mean. Just the messaging has been the same.
I was gonna say the framework and the structure has evolved a little bit, but the teachings are the teachings.
Totally. And again, I haven't been to church for a while, so I can't be the one to do it. But I just even look at like spirituality, how it's taught. Like it used to be like you go to synagogue or you went to a retreat or mm-hmm. different things. Now it's like people are like, well, why do you, that's, you don't need to, like, just get it on a podcast or listen to it in a book or go live your life. And that becomes your spiritual path. Not like you need to go in the Himalayas and sit in a cave around a fire sitting, you know, Indian style, reciting haikus. Like that's not the thing that you need to do, but that's at least when you know, 20 years ago, I had that kind of impression that that's what you needed to do to be spirituality or spiritual life. And that's not true. I mean, I like it when Eckhart Tolle talks to me, he's like, I show up at Starbucks every morning. I drink red wine, right? Like it has nothing to do with the fruits of that stuff.
Yeah. I was going to say, even he is considered a spiritual teacher, right?
Yeah.
Is that what you call him?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, I consume a lot of content from a wide variety of sources, and I'm even noticing even just on almost every podcast, and these are not spiritual teachers.
Yeah.
In any formal sense, it's just business leaders, Instagram influencers, like they're all saying the same thing too. Yeah. And I don't know if it's just the way our culture begun to evolve, and it's just more socially acceptable to have a lot of these conversations. But they're saying a lot of the same things too. It's all about this inner work and about, I guess inner work is the best way I can say it, because they're not using the word spirituality. They're just saying like personal growth, inner work. I mean, that's all the conversations I'm hearing.
Yeah. I mean, I think our societies in general went through this whole shift, and now it's woken up to realizing that the real work, it's not about, you know, food became ubiquitous at some point in the last 100 years, right? Things to a certain extent are becoming relevant and people to be able to grab all over the place, right? Way more. I mean, there wasn't Toys R Us 50 years ago, right? Or 100 years ago.
I'm pretty sure
they're actually in the bankrupt now. Yeah. But so you get my point. Like there wasn't an Amazon that was going to ship everything to your door in 15 seconds, right? So now people have this touch and they realize like, huh, this whole thing of getting things, it's called like being worldly, right? Like going out and trying to change the world, people, places, and things to try to make myself feel okay. It doesn't really work. And now people are using language to kind of pinpoint what that actually is, which is now go do the inner work and then go enjoy everything, right? That's the the point. It's not about renunciation. It's just as bad as going after something. It's not like, okay, I don't feel good for money, so I'm not going to have any money coming in there. I'm not going to see it. I'm not going to lose it. I'm going to drive this. And then you just develop a spiritual ego about you renunciating everything. It's just as versus just allowing it to enjoy whatever it is that's actually in front of you. So the, we talked about charging the ambush, right? And I think part of leaving your legacy, right? The legacy that you have is, could be that teaching of charging the ambush, which is why we're talking about it today. And the way we framed this was, you know, first, always charge the ambush. So think about that as a little mantra, if you will, in your life, or an ethos, if you wanted to put it that way. And then the second component would be that legacy side is truly about your daily teachings, your interactions with people, and how you show up so that you are constantly improving people's lives around you, but not for your own personal need to do that. It may feel really good when you contribute. That's wonderful. It may feel really good when you make money. That's wonderful. Those are just experiences. But you're not doing any of that as a need because you're not whole and complete. You're already whole and complete, so then your teachings become very clear and you're willing to let go of the outcome, have the decisions, and always charge the ambush. Hey, thanks for hanging today and for listening to the show. However, if you are interested in getting a short email from me in your inbox each Tuesday when a new episode drops, you can. These emails are super short. I just cover whatever I happen to be thinking about each week, whether that's an article or a quote I've shared, a book I've read, or a new product that I'm loving, plus info on the latest episode of Business Meets Spirituality. If that sounds like something you want to check out, we'd love you to. Just go to adamhergenrother.com/email.